Welcome to Community Corner. I'm Dr. Patrick Swift, and I'll be the host for this segment. And I'm delighted to have Father Michael Saporito joining us this evening as we start a new series of segments, if you will. God willing, we'll have several more of these in which we have different faith and spiritual leaders within the Maplewood South Orange community to come on to talk about interfaith issues, interfaith dialogue, and most importantly, what's going on in our community. And in the spirit of that, we have Father Michael Saporito here as our first guest for this series of segments, interviews. And Father Michael Saporito is the pastor of St. Joseph's Catholic Church here in Maplewood. And I'm delighted to have you here with us, Father Michael. Thank you for being here.
Nice to be with you.
Thank you for joining us. The drive for this, part of this drive, came out of recently, as a Maplewood resident, I became aware that there is an interfaith network. There is an interfaith, essentially interfaith community in Maplewood, South Orange. Yes. And I was struck by that, particularly post 9/11, with everything going on in the world today. I was heartened to hear it, and at the same time, I was fascinated to hear that we have something like that here. And I wanted to ask, begin our conversation by asking you about what that's about. How is that organized, and what other faiths have joined in that work? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. All of the spiritual leaders of both South Orange and Maplewood have been invited to the Interfaith Clergy Association, which meets monthly, pretty much between September and June. And we vary the locations. People just open up their churches and various meeting spaces for us to gather. And we usually gather on a once a month basis. So, you know, Jewish, Catholic groups, Episcopal groups, Presbyterian groups. We've been, Baptist, all the different denominations that are in the two towns. Anyone who is involved in any way in spiritual work is invited to by the clergy association to join.
What are some of the activities? I know you can't list them all, but what are some of the activities that are going on now in our community, or recently have come about?
Well, I think the major thing that every year there's a couple events that the Interfaith Clergy Association either sponsors or directly. One of them, of course, is the Holocaust Remembrance Service, which is a really big thing in South Orange, Maplewood. It's something that I have not missed, since I've been in Maplewood for 4.5 years. A truly impressive event, and our community at St. Joseph's had the opportunity to host it 2 years ago. So that was even giving a broader picture of interfaith communities coming together to plan such an event over many months, and then to be impressed very much by the witness of the speakers, the way that the towns gather for that, the amount of people that come, the testimony of Holocaust survivors and other survivors of genocide, which we've now even expanded a little bit, has been quite impressive. But it also allows you to see the dedication, the really tremendous dedication of many faiths coming together. That's a big event. the Martin Luther King Day celebration, while the Community Coalition on Race, which is in the towns too, is the big sponsor of that. It was also kind of partnered with the Interfaith Clergy Association on that event, and that's another day that, you know, brings us together around some different a different topic. But again, we see the coming together of racial diversity and talking about the struggles, but wanting to also ensure that that we live in peace in this community, and trying to really come to understand one another as a way of working together. It's really another uplifting a day that's been very much a part of it. One of the big projects that we've undertaken was through Prospect Presbyterian Church had initiated a fundraising campaign for their church, and as part of it, they decided to put some seed money away for a service project which they came up with, which was to sponsor a house to be built through Habitat for Humanity, which was then subsequently named Abraham House. Mm-hmm. The idea was then to get South Orange Maplewood Houses of Worship to join them and join together in building this house, and whether it was from anything from prayers to financial support to the actual labor, those things came together, and that's happening as we speak now.
That's phenomenal, and I'm proud of that for our community. That and the name you've chosen is, or the organization has chosen as well, Abraham House. Mm-hmm. Father Abraham being the father described as the father of these faiths of mm-hmm. Judaism and Christianity and Islam
too.
That's powerful. Mm-hmm. That's happening, and as we speak,
yes,
it goes on. Why are these different faith traditions, as opposed to, I can picture a cynic saying, they're separate. So why come together? Why bother? Why do this?
Yeah. I think, for myself, I think the real answer to that, at least in my mind, is, when I was growing up, I grew up in a neighborhood, really, where most everybody that I knew, was Catholic, and everybody mm-hmm. who was outside of it, might have seemed, to be very different, or we didn't understand. And it really was until I began the study of theology for myself that and started really making contact with other communities. Before I was the pastor in Maplewood, being an assistant in other communities where I worked, it was a real active interfaith community group that used to meet, and we had many services that we would share together over the course of the year. And the mm-hmm. approach in this particular neighborhood was to go to the different communities and actually whatever the tradition was in that community, if we were in a Jewish synagogue, then we would use a Jewish service, and if we were in a Christian place, a Christian service, we were the Catholic community. So and we learned an awful lot. It was an eye-opening experience for me into the similarities, and added to the richness of my own faith by understanding, coming to understand, how different people saw things. And there was a lot of similarity with regard to some real common values, some real things that I think are very, very important, to people, in general. When they talk about, wanting safe neighborhoods, when we talk about having respect for other people, not just in words, but to really have it and to really, enjoy it. It comes to life, and I think that that really makes it, hit home for me. So that was. I kind of really, as an individual, I think I'm kind of, I would describe myself as rather inexperienced with knowing a great deal about a lot of, different faith traditions. And yet at the same time, every time I do learn more through interchanges or projects that we do together, it is not only heartwarming, but it's more than that. It's It's seeing how people have devoted themselves to God, the service of their community and to their people, and there's a real passion in there, and we share that together, and it's very, very common that we can coexist, but also do great things together. And I think that's the hope and the vision that we would have.
And it's incredible you share that you might not be well versed in all the different teachings within all these different faith traditions, but coming with it from a sense of humility, faith, and service. Mm-hmm. This recently there was a New York Times article in which Pope Benedict was encouraging the Roman Catholic clergy to engage in meaningful interreligious dialogue in France, particularly. This was said in Lourdes. But he was quoted as saying, goodwill is not enough. Mm-hmm. And when I read those words, I felt that was, I've got to mention this in our interview, the notion the notion of goodwill is not enough. We've got to do, as you're saying, we've got to do more. Is there a particular Catholic stance within the Catholic teaching on interfaith issues? However you want to answer that, is there a general stance, a general teaching that you can share with us about what the perspective is for a practicing Catholic as well as for non-Catholics to see how they're taught to engage in interfaith dialogue?
Well, sure. I think the opening door to really all of this and the big boom that we had with regard to interreligious dialogue really came out of the Second Vatican Council, which took place between 1962 and 1965. And it was not only a throwing open of the windows in the Catholic Church, but it really was a throwing out of an opening of the windows really to the whole world and embracing our fellow brothers and sisters, and saying all faiths hold truth within them, and coming together, talking about those things, and as you say, acting on those, as the Pope points out, as we would say, certainly as Catholics, that would be true. We don't want to only talk about the gospel; we want to live the gospel. I think that's true in interreligious dialogue too. That we want to make it more than words. We want to, make it something that is very, very tangible for people to see so that they're energized, by it too. Because it's one thing, I think, for religious leaders to be energized by such a vision, but how does it get down to the common folk who come into our churches, synagogues, mosques, or whatever, and how do we transmit to everybody else that this is just as it's very, very important, for all of us to understand.
Absolutely. There's tremendous wisdom in that perspective, and I'm heartened by that. Mm-hmm. And I hope that people take heart from that. We are going to take a break, and when we come back, hopefully we can, people will stick around and we can get to some more interesting questions about any particular interfaith experience you've had and also from the teachings of Mother Teresa and applied faith and respect in different traditions. So, okay. We'll be right back.
Faster than searching the World Wide Web, more inspiring than a half-calf mocha latte, able to answer any question with insight and detail. This superhero of knowledge can find the answer to any question, no matter what the problem. And she works in your neighborhood at your public library. When you need to know, get to know your library. Log on to njlibraries.org.
Welcome back to Community Corner. I'm here with Father Michael Saporito, and we're discussing interfaith dialogue, interfaith issues, and most importantly, what's happening here in Maplewood and applied faith. As we were rounding out the last part, we got to talking about applied the implication of applied faith. And I, as you know, and as viewers might know, I'm the author of One Mountain, Many Paths, and someone who's committed to interfaith dialogue and working for peace in our world from our different perspectives. And there's a quote I want to read to you from Mother Teresa, and get your input on your thoughts about that. It's Mother Teresa is quoted as saying that there is only one God, and He's God to all. Therefore, it is important that everyone is seen as equal before God. I've always said we should help a Hindu become a better Hindu, a Muslim become a better Muslim, a Catholic become a better Catholic. We believe our work should be our example to people. The wisdom in that quote, I think, touches on that which we speak of. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to hear your thoughts on how someone can be grounded in their own faith, and someone who arguably might be have been a saint among us, to be that embracing of people from different faiths, particularly as a person who lived in a very multicultural society. We do here, but in India there's a mixing and matching and harmony and resonance and dissonance, mm-hmm. That brings all these people together with so much history of religion and spirituality. It'd be interesting to hear your thoughts about how someone can have their applied faith and still have such a reaching out to other people.
I think first that, I believe that it first is a matter of faith, that I think Mother, obviously to say Mother Teresa's faith was very, very deep, might seem to be very trivial, but it was extremely deep, yeah. And I think one needs to feel comfortable in who they are, and I would say that even as and it's something that I've come to understand, in ministry. And to tell you the truth, Patrick, I would tell you that it's really through what I would call a personal failure of my own that I realized that very early on in my seminary education, I was going to work with the Boys and Girls Clubs in Newark, and they wanted someone with a faith background to be part of the program, and they didn't tell me why. They just said, Michael, will you go? And so I decided to take the chance and went. And
this was before priesthood?
Before priesthood. I was just was preparing in the seminary. I think I'd only been there for a year, so it was really the whole world of seminary, religious thought, everything was very, very, very different. I was following that path. But I really wasn't quite sure where it was, exactly leading at that point. And I was there, and I just decided that, I was in front of these children and trying to, they had this after school program, and I was trying to, teach them these lessons. And I figured out, this isn't what, I signed up for. And I ended up walking away from it because I didn't really understand the impact of what Mother Teresa was talking about, that my example could actually say something. I didn't have to be doing necessarily a quote religious thing, but providing a little stability to kids that maybe didn't have it, or recognizing them as one with me and not different, mm-hmm. And I think I learned a lot through that failure. So it's a combination of both experience and faith, coming together that really allows those learnings, to take place. I think sometimes in many segments of our own society, and we've had struggles on many different issues with when we're all the same people, living together, much of the outside world seems to be outsiders, and it's hard to let the quote outsider in. or to understand someone who's very, very different from us. But once you begin to do that and engage it, you find that there's so much more to it than you could ever imagine. And I think that is one of the things that I still find, amazing about what I said to you before, my really, what I say is, inexperience with regard to knowing a lot about other faiths, yet being drawn sometimes by the richness of what those other beliefs are, what those other, faiths are all about, how common we are in some of those things, and how I wouldn't be out, to change, somebody's faith from one thing to another. That, I think that's right. I mean, I would want, Catholics to be, stronger Catholics, as Mother Teresa would say, and to respect those who had their faith and mm-hmm. would want them to, pursue their faith and give their heart to the best of their ability. Because in the end, I think it makes us better people. It ends up opening our hearts, and sometimes in ways we could have never imagined.
It reminds me of the book Lance Armstrong wrote, that it's not about the bike.
Yeah.
In a sense, it's not about most importantly, it's about love as an action.
Yeah.
As Pope Benedict said.
Yes.
Paying lip service, the quote, goodwill is not enough.
Right.
There has to be action behind it. When I do radio interviews about interfaith dialogue, one of the things that's thrown to me is, isn't interfaith dialogue just different faith traditions trying to convert everybody else to their side?
Yeah.
What do you say to that?
I don't think anything could be, further from the truth. I mean, certainly when we sit...
They're not trying to get him to join
another
camp.
We're not trying to get... It's funny even to, each community has their own, different idiosyncrasies, mm-hmm. Sometimes about the way the churches are structured and operate. And sometimes, that's, a little comic relief in the middle of everything. But I think... Even at times in our clergy association here, sometimes mm-hmm. What we've done is, as part of the meetings, is to hear from other, to just give a little like overview of, what could be some of the, particular points of interest, if one was, to be part of your faith tradition, and to talk about it so that we can learn from one another and to not be afraid of, I don't know what that is or those kinds of things, but to really understand. And that does give you insight into the mindset of how people approach, all kinds of things, because I think all faith traditions try to have us all incorporate our faith into our lives. And if we understand what we're incorporating into our minds and lives, it'll help us to understand each other, to be more effective in carrying out any kind of common mission. When we become ignorant of it, or we choose to, or to not engage it in that way, it could lead to more problems than good.
And the destruction of community as
exactly.
opposed to
exactly.
building community.
Instead of the building of community, right. Right.
There's a book I was recently reading, Beyond Tolerance, and it speaks to the importance of it not just being religious dialogue isn't just about holding your nose.
Right.
it's about an intention and an action, yeah. There's great power within our community.
Mm-hmm.
I'm proud of this community. Mm-hmm. There is such diversity here. There's such a strength here. And not everyone looks the same, and not everyone drives the same car, and
right.
not everyone goes to the same church.
Right.
And not everyone goes to church.
Right.
Or temple or mosque. Right. But there is, that's actually a characteristic within St. Joseph's as well.
Yes.
It might be a Catholic community, but that is a community that has a fair amount of diversity, if I understand correctly.
Yes, it does. A great deal of diversity. And it is a great blessing, There are certainly challenges that come with that, as anybody who would be trying, you know, to bring diverse groups of people together knows that there's always going to be challenges there. But boy, when it works, it is really something beautiful to behold, because the commonality of purpose that really, you know, takes over and unites us, even from different perspectives, places, parts of the world, is absolutely amazing.
Are there, Father Michael, are there any activities that you know of in the future calendar that people might be interested in getting involved with the interfaith? In the name of it's the Interfaith
Clergy Association.
Interfaith Clergy Association. Yeah. Do you know of any upcoming events? Or would you recommend people to reach out to Abraham House, for example? Or is there anything else that comes to mind that people could get involved with? Because one of the things that struck me when I found out that this exists, and I've written a book about it, and I'm passionate about it, I'm out there, I'm actually risking my career in being a well-grounded, academically titled psychologist in a medical center, and here I am saying, there's faith, there's community. But I do it anyway. What can we get involved with around here?
Well, I would say I wouldn't have too much with regard to new initiatives at this point, but every one of those things that I mentioned before, from the Holocaust Remembrance Service to Abraham House to the Martin Luther King celebration. I know we're back working towards doing something at Thanksgiving time too. It was a practice that apparently went on, you know, sometime in interfaith at Thanksgiving time, and we're trying to, you know, revive that again. But any time I've ever attended these, you know, these meetings with the clergy council and the people who are involved, they say, "Do you know anybody else that can help?" Because, you know, typical of these things with volunteers.
Okay.
The clergy person in your faith tradition would be a great, you know, person, because
to let them know that you're interested in
interfaith work, and that's a great resource. And I know that's how we ended up getting St. Joseph's got back involved in the Holocaust Remembrance Service, and then one of our parishioners became, you know, a co-chair, you know, to the event, and we ended up hosting the event. So all of that happened because, you know, someone came to visit me because I was new in town, and they had come to visit me. They sat down with me. I was very, very interested in pursuing it. I put something out, and I was lucky that somebody came forward and said, I'd like to be part of that. And we made the connections, and that's how things began to roll for us.
And I think that speaks to hospitality, faith in action, connecting. If there's one thing, we've got about 45 seconds, if there's one thing you would tell someone about how they can make a difference in regards to interfaith dialogue, what would you tell them?
How can you make a difference? I think that it's to be aware. I think awareness is very, very key. We have our faith traditions. We're involved. We may be involved in those communities, but being aware of what's going on, you know, in your community.
I love it. I love it. It just speaks to the importance of being aware within the heart action. Thank you, Father Michael. I want to thank Father Michael Saporito for joining us.
Thank you, Patrick.
I think we've got to wrap up here, but I hope people will tune in the future. We can have other faith leaders coming on as well to talk about our community and what's happening here and how we work together to make our community stronger and more loving and better for our families and for our children. So thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us, and until next time.